Hi everyone. So today we'll actually start the third part of the semester, which covers the last outcomes of this class. So until now, we basically discussed about data structures. We talked about time and memory efficiency. This is a time complexity analysis that we talked about, the big O notations. The rest of the semester will spend on understanding the paradigms of programming languages and functional programming. This is a very important technique for in programming that is now used in JavaScript mainly, because basically being asynchronous calls when a client or one computer calls sends a message to another computer, it sends also a callback function. So functions are basically passed as arguments between computers. So really what we will talk about today is a high level view of programming languages. And then we'll probably spend the rest of the semester talking about functional programming in particular. So today we'll actually have a very straightforward introduction to programming languages. So at the beginning, there was only machine language. These were basically gates, digital gates, a sequence of bits that directly control the processor, causing it to add, compare, move data from one place in memory to another. And basically everything was binary. You would switch a bunch of switches to encode the binary number. Zero is off, one is on. And then basically giving these instructions as basically switches on a machine, the machine would basically allow the current to execute a certain instruction. And here we have an example of such a program that computes GCD in on an 8x86 machine. And I'm basically using hexadecimal to encode the binary digits that you would have underneath. So really at the beginning, if you have seen that movie with Benedict Cumberbatch on Enigma machine, it was only about binary code. It was only about machine language. Now, of course, that was not readable by most humans. We don't read binary. So assembly languages were invented to allow operations to be expressed with mnemonic abbreviations. That basically meant that now we have a name for that binary instruction that is encoded in the machine language. For instance, to add two numbers, one might write an instruction as the one that follows: add register one with register two into register three, put the result in register three. So really this was just English representation, controlled natural language for the same machine language instructions that you had on that machine. Now a program called, so you would pass the program into strings, like for instance, this add instruction. And there was an interpreter basically implemented on the in the machine that would take this string representation and convert this assembly language into the machine code that is executable code. Now this can be, this assembler can be a compiler that basically takes all of these instructions and generates machine code file, an executable file in the file system. Or it could be even in an interpreter that takes instruction by instruction and executes it. We'll see the difference between compilers and interpreters in a couple of seconds. So we had machine language, which was really just implementing as logical gates the program that you want to implement. Then we had assembly, which were just mnemonic abbreviations for the machine language. And you can see here an example of GCD program, the same program in x86, basically in this assembly language. It's identical with what this binary code that we have on bottom here is, but it's written in readable instructions by humans. Assemblers were eventually augmented with macro expansion, which is the idea of methods that it permits programmers to define a parameterized abbreviation for a common set of instructions. And now you could invoke that macro, that method, to execute, like for instance, GCD or other sets of instructions that are commonly used in multiple places. The problem still was that every kind of computer, every kind of machine had to be programmed in its own assembly language because the underlying machine language was different. So people started to wish for machine-independent languages, languages that would not depend on a certain architecture, if it's x86 Intel, or if it's an Apple processor, or if it's any kind of ARM processor and so on, because they have different machine languages, non-standardized between themselves, and assembly languages are just mnemonic representations of those machine languages. So really what happens in the 1950s was the beginning of higher level programming languages that were defined independent of the machine, and then they would be compiled into the various machines' languages by compilers. So you would have a compiler for Fortran on x86 or the equivalent of x86 in IBM. Or you would have a compiler for Fortran into another machine level language, like IBM machine level language and so on. Today we have thousands of such high level programming languages, Java, Python, C. They are all high level programming languages, and new ones emerge all the time, basically based on evolution, that some instructions become simpler, some languages become easier. There are languages developed specifically for special purposes, like theorem provers, let's say, or verifiers. There is also a matter of personal preference. Maybe some of you like to program in Java, maybe some in JavaScript, maybe some in Python. So really, it's a matter of personal preference. So what exactly makes a language successful? There are many different languages. Some are successful because they are easy to learn with a short learning curve. Like for instance, somebody may become a Python programmer for small programs, but they basically learn Python on their own. There are other languages in which it's easy to express things that are very powerful. And C was at the time such a language. It basically, compared with Fortran, the syntax of C or of Java is much simpler, but they implement the same kind of powerful objects. Some of these languages are popular because it was easy to implement or deploy. Like for instance, for JavaScript, you just need a browser because the browser has internally a JavaScript compiler or a JavaScript engine that runs basically your program. It's possible to compile to fast code, C or Fortran. C, even today, it's about an order of magnitude faster than Java, and two orders of magnitude, so 100 times faster than Python. Also, some languages were successful because somebody makes them free. Like they basically allowed programmers like us to use their compilers to develop programs. And Java was such a language before it was basically bought by Oracle. When it was developed by Sun, it was basically a free language. You didn't have, and older versions of Java still have that basically copyright that allows you to use them and deploy them for free. And really, in my opinion, that makes a language very successful is minimal cost. Python, Java, Pascal, Turing, Erlang basically were popular at their time because basically the cost to buy them and deploy them to customers was free in most cases. Why do we have so many programming languages? because it's a way of thinking. So some programming languages allow us to develop programs in easier ways than others, depending on the program. Basically, in some languages, like in logic programming, you can specify logical formulas. And therefore, you can specify theorem proving problems or mathematical problems, and they will be basically inferred, the results will be inferred automatically. Some languages are easy to use, basically like Python or Java or JavaScript. You can open just the console in your browser and you can start writing JavaScript programs or JavaScript code. And also some programming languages are used because they basically can access the hardware and very low level features in the hardware, like the ports, the sockets, and so on. Why do we want to study different programming languages? It helps us to choose the best programming language for the task, like for system programming, like the Linux kernel. You would know that you would have to use C or C++ because they are implemented in those languages and for the reason that they have to be extremely fast. For numerical computations, you would use MATLAB, Python, R. For embedded systems, you would use Android, Objective-C or Swift, JavaScript lately. For symbolic data manipulation, like theorem proving, you would use Python, Ruby, Common Lisp, Scheme, SML that we will cover in this class. For networked applications, you would use RESTful interface or remote procedure calls. So basically you would know what to use for a specific task that you have. It also makes it easier to learn new programming languages. Basically languages, if you look at them, they are very similar to each other. And the reason is that they are developed in a family tree. Like for instance, the developers of Java were initially developers in C. So they basically borrowed a lot of features from C into the new programming language. Similar for JavaScript, they were actually programmers in Java. So they would basically use the same block notation, the same statements for loops, and so on. And concepts at the lower level are even more similar. You basically learn iteration. You don't need to learn it in a certain programming language because it works in the same way in many different programming languages, for loops, while loops. Recursion is the same idea that you basically learn it in one programming language and then you write in a different syntax, but it's the same concept. Really what you should think about is the fact that you basically, the better you are at learning languages makes it easier for you to learn a new language. For instance, I know three different languages that are in this Indo-European family, like English, Romanian, and Italian. And it's easier for me to pick up new languages, especially Latin-based languages like French, because there are a lot of similarities between Romanian and Italian and French. And German, because there are similarities between English and German. Another reason why you should learn programming languages, multiple programming languages, is because you understand obscure features. Basically, if you learn C, you would understand what a union is, how you can occupy the same space with two different type objects. You will know how to manipulate pointers, how arrays are stored in memory, how to throw and catch exceptions. In Common Lisp, you would learn what are the different types of functions, the first class functions, which basically means that you can pass it as a parameter, how to build a variable environment, basically the closure, what is the set of points in the program where a variable is visible. And again, you will basically learn how to throw and catch exceptions, how symbols are internally represented in a symbol table. Also, learning multiple programming languages makes you understand implementation costs. You will know when to use, for instance, x multiply with x versus x square. This x multiply with x is much faster than x square because x square is basically, it's a function that basically it's implemented with a macro expansion, depending how many times, to what power you want to raise that value. So you will basically learn what is the faster way to implement a certain function. Also, you will know how to basically pass large objects from in some languages like Pascal or newer languages. What call by name is an algol is basically when you are passing a name as a parameter. So you basically can use in the new function that name that you had in the parent method or the parent that called the current function. Also, you will know when to choose between computation, that's basically you invoke a function and you compute what that function does, and table lookup or memoization or tabling, where you basically instead of recomputing, you would just use the values that you got for that function in previous calls. Also, learning a lot of languages will help you figure out how to do things in languages that don't support them. Like for instance, in the original Fortran, there was no recursion. So basically you can implement recursion by using go to statements, jumps. And you would basically, you have to be careful how you can jump through these steps. Now, some languages eliminated jumps and then you still had to do it in some way, basically implement recursion. Also, the original Fortran did not have commas. So in order, and also it didn't have constants. So in order to communicate with other programmers, what do you want about an identifier to be a constant or a variable? Some styling features were added, like for instance, the fact that constants are all uppercase letters. Because basically now if some other programmer would find the same identifier would know not to assign anything to it because basically it's a constant. So there are many different languages and they are classified in various classes. And there are many different classifications of programming languages. The most common one, standard one, is that you have imperative languages, those that are basically based on variables that can be modified. And these are also called the von Neumann or Turing architecture. Basically, you have a memory that contains variables. Your program is executed step by step from basically top of the program to the bottom of the program main method. This is basically the idea of the Turing abstract machine, that you start from a state and you continue in the cells of the tape. So it's similar to that. In imperative programming, you start from the top of your main method and you execute every statement. Sometimes you have to go and execute a method and return back. But this is basically the imperative programming languages. Some programming languages, imperative programming languages, are object-oriented. That means that basically the programmer can use inheritance to define more general classes, then lower level classes will inherit all the data fields and methods. And you can also override the methods from the superclass. Initially, the first object-oriented language was Smalltalk, and then basically, there were many others, Eiffel, C++, I think it was the next one, and then Java. Scripting languages evolved as simple languages that ran in a shell, like for instance, the Bash, and you would be able to write simple programs to manipulate files and strings. And Python originated in that way from Perl, a more older language with a word, I would say, more wordly syntax. JavaScript evolved as a scripting language to modify web pages. PHP as a server-side scripting language. Now we have JavaScript on the server with Node.js. Then there is a separate class of programming languages called declarative programming languages, which are basically programming languages that map to a mathematical formalism in which you can basically define structures and reason about those structures. And we usually classify these declarative programming languages into functional programming languages, which are based on mathematical functions, and logic programming languages, which are based on first order logic. Functional programming languages are, for instance, Scheme or Lisp or SML that we will actually see in this class, which maps directly exactly to how we write functions in mathematics. Functional programming languages is adopted these days by JavaScript for callback methods. You call a method on some remote server and you pass a callback function. So you're not expecting that method to return back. You're expecting that server to call back to this current agent the result. So it's basically an example where functions become arguments, or they become first class citizens. They can be passed as parameters in another function. Logic-based languages, they are used in theorem proving, either for verification of a system. Lots of systems developed for DoD, for instance, are based on logic-based programming languages because they carry their own proof. You can justify why some execution succeeds, and you can basically modify the logic in case that you want it to be executed differently. And there are also object-oriented programming languages like Flora or constraint-based programming languages like AnswerSet programming. There are many other classifications of programming languages. There are programming languages called markup languages, which are just for basically presenting documents. HTML, it's a markup language. The ML in HTML, hypertext markup language, is basically a programming language that is only concerned about look of that page. Assembly languages, there are hardware languages, like for instance, PostScript, which basically, and there are 3D printing languages in which the instructions are how to move the head of the printer. So you can basically make a figure, but that's also a programming language. So talking about this classification, here is the same program, the greatest common divider in different languages. This is the C implementation. This is the SML implementation that we will see next class. This is the Python implementation, which basically it's similar to C, is imperative. You start from the top of the function and you execute it. You have jumps like if else statements. And this is the Prolog implementation. It's actually implemented in Stony Brook Prolog. SB in XSB stands for Stony Brook. And basically what that defines are logical implications. The first statement says if A is equal with B, then the greatest common divider is equal with A. And that implies the GCD will return for A equal with B the same value. And similar for if A is greater than B and C is the difference between A minus B, and the greatest common divider between C, B is G, then the greatest common divider between A and B is G. So it's really this colon dash that you see here is implication in logic. And what I just wrote there is basically a recursive definition of GCD that defines the base case and then a recursive case. And it's all written in logic. That's first order logic. In fact, a subset of first order logic called Horn rules, which basically is decidable for programs without function symbols. Now, if we backtrack a little bit, programming languages usually run on your computer in two different ways, as a compiler or as an interpreter, or as a mix of both, okay? So they are not opposites. There is no clear-cut distinction, but I will explain to you what a compiler does, what an interpreter does, and what other systems are on top. Like, for instance, you have a preprocessor that does macro expansion, eliminates comments, and so on. So I will explain to you the stages of a programming language, how a programming language takes a program and basically takes an input from the user and takes actually a source code program, generates executable code, which takes the input from the user and generates output. So a pure compiler basically takes the high level source code and transforms it into an equivalent target program, typically machine language in a pure compiler, and then goes away. So basically we take the source code like Java code, let's say, or C code, we compile it into binary code like machine language, and now that binary code is executed. You take input from the user, so you can even prompt the user to enter some input. You do some computation internally and you produce output. This is what a pure compiler does. It translates the source code into binary code or machine executable code. Interpretation is the other way to do this, the other technology to do this. Basically, the interpreter is an executable machine code itself. It stays around for the execution of the program. It takes statements from the source program, sentence by sentence, statement by statement. And then when it needs to basically take some input from the user, it also takes the input from the user and it produces output. So basically we have this interpreter that stays on during the execution and still takes statement by statement from the source program and executes each one of them. Basically internally it translates it into executable code, or it just executes with the code of the interpreter what it needs from that source code, the original program. So this is a pure interpretation. That, for instance, you have an interpreter that takes statement by statement and executes them. You can think of the Python interpreter. So the Python interpreter is like that. I don't know which one of you took Python, but basically you enter a statement like print A, and it basically prints A. And then you enter a different statement, print B, and it executes B. So this is an example of an interpreter. Basically it stays on and takes statement by statement and executes them. As opposed to a compiler, like for instance for C, that takes your program, transforms it into binary code, which is executable file. Java is basically, Java C is a compiler. It takes source code and generates virtual machine code, or Java virtual machine code. Now, there are advantages and disadvantages of both. Compilation has better performance. If you optimize your entire program into the machine level, you know the entire program, you know what instructions can be executed concurrently or in parallel, compilation is the best. And that's why most of the operating systems, for instance, Linux, is written in C, which is compiled into executable code. Interpretation gives you greater flexibility. You run statement by statement, you can modify the statements. So the next statement depends actually on the previous one execution. You also get better diagnostics, better error messages. You know exactly where you failed and why you failed. Most programming languages today actually include a mixture of both compilation and interpretation. And the reason for that is that basically Java started with this idea that you can run anywhere, written once, run anywhere, which really the meaning of that means that you've wrote a source code program, you don't know, you don't care on what architecture it will run. You translate it with a compiler like Java C into this intermediate representation like virtual binary code. And that virtual binary code is executed on a virtual machine, which is an interpreter that basically it's implemented especially for that specific machine. So for instance, you have a virtual machine, Java virtual machine for Windows, a Java virtual machine for Mac, for Linux, and so on. So basically, you have this interpreter, which is Java, in the case of Java, that stays around and executes your Java bytecode representation, which was obtained as the result of a compiler. So now it's true that in some cases compilation doesn't produce machine language, because you basically produce machine language when you wanted an executable, like for instance for C you wanted .exe file. But we saw in the previous case that you basically translated from the source code into Java bytecode or some intermediate program which is executed on a virtual machine. So it's not always true that a compiler translates from source code into a different, into a machine language code. In fact, the original C++ compilers would translate from C++ into C. So basically you would have to now follow up with another set of compiler to actually compile it into executable code. So really compilation is just this translation phase from one higher level language into another, okay? Compilation also has some other internal processes, semantic understanding of types and syntax, pre-processing, like basically you do some expansion of macros, and you basically do this translation with some understanding of the code. Pre-processing itself, which is actually a sub-phase, the first phase of compilation, does not know anything about the semantic understanding of the program. It basically just does a transformation, a syntactic transformation of the program. Compilation is also a semantic understanding of the program. It can understand what's the type of variables. It can detect compiler errors, basically errors which are due to misunderstandings by the programmer, like the type that you assign to a variable. Many compiled languages also have interpreters assigned to them. So for instance, in Fortran and C, some instructions like for instance, set operations in Pascal, string manipulations in BASICS were done by an interpreter. So after compilation, you don't have executable code. You would basically have code that uses some libraries which are going to be executed like an interpreter style to execute some functions. So you would also have to link some libraries, and these libraries are basically interpreters that may actually even parse your source code to execute it on the fly. The first thing that I mentioned about compilers is the preprocessor. So the preprocessor is the first step of a compiler, which removes comments and white spaces. It groups the characters into tokens, keywords, identifiers, numbers, symbols. It expands macros or abbreviations, which basically they are like functions. They you define a macro in one point at the beginning of the program, and then when you encounter that identifier somewhere else in the program, you just override that location with the definition of that macro, with the body of that macro. It identifies, preprocessors also identify higher level syntactical structures like loops, subroutines. It has if-else statements, but really these if-else statements are for compiler directives. So basically, depending on what operating system you would have, it would choose one library or another library, okay? The C preprocessor basically does the removal of the comments, expands the macros, and does conditional compilation. What we saw down here, this depending on what operating system you would have, you would decide what libraries to import. And this is an example of a C preprocessor. So basically the source program is first passed to the preprocessor, which modifies that program lightly by expanding macros, ignoring or basically commenting or eliminating code that is not for that compilation. So it's conditional for whatever compilation operating system we have. And we would get a modifying source program for that specific computer, for that specific operating system, which now can be passed to the compiler, the rest of the compiler, and compiled into assembly or binary code. The next strategy used by the compiler is called linking. So C programming basically needed a linker. The compiler would basically transform the program into some machine language with hooks, with locations where some libraries were called, like mathematical functions such as sinus, cosinus. And then you would have to link those additional libraries, basically jumps from those incomplete machine language that was obtained for the original program with the actual libraries, executable code in binary that was generated for those libraries. And then you would get one machine language program as the result. So it was basically another step for linking standard methods to the rest of the compiled program. Now, some compilers output is assembly. And the reason for that is that that is still readable. People can read assembly, is mnemonic representations of machine language. And basically now that would need to be again compiled or interpreted on an assembler. So an assembler is basically another smaller compiler that will compile assembly languages into machine language. Also, it was good because it would isolate the compiler from changes to the machine language. Maybe some instructions are added or removed. And then all that we need to change is the assembler. Usually machine languages have much fewer instructions, like 40 to 100, than you would have in higher level languages, where you have thousands of methods. You would basically just use a subset of assembly instructions. Another way to implement a new programming language is source-to-source translation. The original C++ implementation developed at AT&T Labs basically was object-oriented programs would be compiled into C code. So basically methods would be preceded by the class name. You would also add an object or a variable for the current object, for this object. And really, it was just a higher level compiler that would compile the C++ program into C code. And then we would use a compiler for C to assembly or source or machine language. But how were the original programming languages implemented? They were implemented with a technology or technique called bootstrapping. So bootstrapping really was that one would write a small implementation of the programming language that they want to implement, usually an interpreter, which basically would implement simple steps, like what is a for loop, what is a method. And then once you have such a small interpreter, then you write the rest of the programming language, that programming language that you originally wanted to implement, in the smaller subset of the language that is already compiled by that interpreter. So that is called bootstrapping. Basically, assemblers were the first example of languages that would bootstrap themselves. Basically, you would implement 5-10 instructions in binary, in a machine language, and then you would write the rest of the assembler in assembly code itself, and you would use the previous iterations of the assembly to compile your code. Java is such an example. It's a self-hosted language. If you are looking at the source code that comes with JDK, you would basically see that all the classes that we use, like system or string, they're implemented in Java themselves. And the reason for that is that originally, the only thing that was implemented was the Java binary, the JVM, in assembly. And then you would basically write the rest of Java with a simple parser to assembly in Java itself. It's basically a form of what we call dog fooding, eat your own dog food, basically. You make the programming language, use it. And it's actually quite good because you will now see if you need to do improvements directly in that programming. And it's a comprehensive check to test that you can you actually write the current programming language in the current programming language. So it's a good way to test your own programming language. Also, bootstrapping strapping is related to self-hosting. Basically, when you actually develop a new operating system and you would host it on that same operating system itself. So for instance, Unix started that way by Ken Thompson. He wrote an initial Unix kernel with a simple command interpreter, an editor, an assembler, and few utilities. And then the rest of the Unix operating system became self-hosting. Programs can be now written in and tested in Unix itself. And similar for Linux. So Linux started hosted on a Minix system, basically another operating system that was similar to Linux. Linux was highly inspired by Minix. And once there were sufficient packages like GCC compiler, GNU bash, and other utilities available, then developers would move to the Linux kernel itself. They will basically implement the Linux kernel on the current Linux implementation. And this is what is happening today. Like basically, people are developing the next generation of Linux kernel on machines running the previous generation of Linux kernel. There are also interpreted languages which are compiled. So functional programming languages or Python, for instance, are programming languages that usually are interpreted. But there are compilers for these programming languages too. When you have a final program and you want the best possible execution of that program, then you would basically, you can compile it into executable code. I can give you as an example in Stony Brook Prolog. Basically, this is a Stony Brook a programming language developed at Stony Brook for many, many years. Basically, the first step is to compile that Prolog program into XWAM or WAM, Waran Abstract Machine. It's an abstract machine that was invented before Java Virtual Machine way back in the 80s. Another implementation strategy for programming languages is just-in-time compilation. Basically, you would not compile anything, any instructions, until you actually need it. So it's a little bit different than an interpreter. An interpreter basically interprets every single statement that comes one by one. Just-in-time compiler, it's still a compiler, but you don't compile the code into executable code until you actually need to execute that code. So you can optimize the compilation of that code the moment that you actually need to compile it. So you can basically do last steps optimizations on that code. And an example again of that is dynamic indexing in Prolog. So indexing is similar to database indexing. You can call a method in logic programming with any one of the arguments bound and other arguments not bound. And you want to create an index on the fly. So basically you want to create an index when you need it, just that moment, not before you need it. So dynamic indexing is such an example. Basically you create an index the moment that you need it. You don't want to occupy more space and you don't want to create it unless you actually need it on demand. Assembly level instructions are not implemented in hardware. They run in an interpreter, but there are these codes which are basically implemented on the hardware and they are called microcodes or firmware, which are stored in read-only memory on the hardware and executed usually when you start your computer or you basically execute some hardware program. So they are very low level instructions written, and actually they are stored in the hardware itself, microcode. There are also unconventional compilers. For instance, many of you learned TeX, LaTeX. And LaTeX, basically, it's a compiler. You describe, it's a markup language which is compiled into PDF, or it's compiled into executable printing language. And this is another example of a compiler, silicon compilers. Laser printers, they basically, the instructions that go to the laser printer are print statements, like printn A. But internally, it has to actually move the head of the printer to printn A, because basically it's a, it doesn't have letters. It has pixels internally, okay? Query languages, like for databases, like SQL databases, are also an example of compiled languages. They're, first of all, they are programming languages for querying database systems or creating schemas in database systems. And you need to translate them into more primitive operations, like relational calculus. A select statement is transformed into basically filtering of the tuples, joins, and projection on certain attributes that we want in the result. So really, there are also programming languages which are compiled internally into relational algebra. Also, when we talk about programming languages, another feature, another set of tools are IDEs. They are basically compilers, interpreters. Programming languages in general do not exist in isolation. Programmers need tools like editors, like pretty printers, preprocessors, debuggers, style checkers, module management systems like like executional scripting languages like Make, version management, assemblers, and all of these are basically tools necessary for development of a program or a large software. So let's talk about the compilation steps. So this semester, the rest of the semester, we'll learn functional programming. And if we have time, we will learn the phases of compilation. So you have the source code program. This is a character stream. You have, let's say, F, O, R, space, open parentheses, and so on. That's a stream of characters that is the source code. The first step is called the scanner or lexical analysis. What happens, it basically starts from the beginning of this stream and starts grouping the keyword, the characters into words, like class, for, and so on. And the reason for that is that parsing is known to be a cubic time. So in order to parse a program in a certain grammar, you basically have cubic time in the size of the program. And if you have a program of 100, let's say, characters, you would basically need somewhere close to 100,000 steps to parse it if you would parse it at character level. But we don't parse it at character level. We basically transform the character into tokens. A sequence of characters would be transformed into words, like, for instance, for, parentheses, class, and so on. Now, these tokens will be arranged into a parse tree by the parser. So the parser knows what's the syntax that, let's say in English, you have subject followed by verb phrase. A verb phrase could be a determiner, a verb followed by an object, and the object is a determiner followed by a noun, and so on. So these are basically parsing rules. What is a statement? What is the correct statement, and how basically it forms a statement, how the different tokens form a statement, and the output is a parse tree. This parse tree is just a syntactic parse tree. Now we actually have to understand the semantics behind it, like a for loop, or we have to understand the method call. So this is done by the semantic analysis and intermediate code generation, which generates an abstract syntax tree or some other intermediate form, which now also has ideas about what the statements are, that this is a for loop, what are the limits, and it basically generates kind of pseudo code in the background, how the program will be executed. Now you will basically do optimizations. So basically this tree, abstract syntax tree, can be optimized into more optimal, less number of steps, intermediate form. Sometimes you can take into consideration the final objective, the machine level, and you can basically do optimizations at that level, like a power operation can be transformed into a multiplication. So all of these are basically steps into a compiler. And we start with the first one, scanning. So scanning is the recognition of a regular language. And when you learn, when you do CSC 303 or basically theory of computation, you would basically learn that basically you can define regular languages which are recognized in the length of the language itself. And basically you can recognize tokens, which are basically the smallest meaningful units or the words. You are given characters and you recognize the words. The IDs, you can recognize the numbers. And you basically, instead of doing parsing character by character, the next step, you will do it word by word, okay? So for instance, if I give this GCD program, the first step in the compilation of this GCD program would give me the tokens that it identifies that that program starts with the type int, the name of the method is main, then open parentheses, close parentheses, open bracket, again, the type int, the variable I, and so on. So it basically transforms from characters to words. The next phase is parsing. So parsing is the recognition of a context-free language. And usually what it means, context-free language, it means that it doesn't connect, it doesn't consider the internal properties of the different words, of the different tokens. So the easiest way to describe it is a parsing for English. In English, it's grammatically correct to say he teaches English or I teach English. And the what we can see in this I teach and he teaches is the fact that you have a coordination, that you have a context-sensitive grammar, where the gender, or not the gender, but the number of the and the person of the subject has to agree with the number and of the verb. So basically you have a context sensitivity in the parser. Programming languages don't have context sensitivity. And the reason why is that it's cheaper and faster to do context-free parsing, where you basically have these words and you basically want to combine them into sentences. And this is an example of a grammar. So a grammar basically states in C that it's a while followed by open parentheses, followed by a logical expression, followed by close parentheses, followed by statement. And then you have ways to define these, like a statement is a compound statement, where a compound statement could be a block, and a block contains a block of items, and the block item list contains a list, and the list contains an item, or a list followed by an item, and so on. So basically you have a grammar, like you would have an English grammar, and the parser would take the tokens and organize them into a tree. And that tree is a parse tree. Basically, it tells me for that same GCD program that it starts with a declaration, then it has the name of the function, main, and it contains basically the entire structure of the syntax that parses that specific tree, that specific program. So you can see that, for instance, the entire block of statements will be into a compound statement, and then it creates the list of all of the statements, which this parse tree was big enough that I can represent it in three different slides. Now, once we have the parse tree, the next phase is called semantic analysis. So semantic analysis does what is called the static semantic analysis, where it tries to figure out at compile time if there are errors, like some programming languages would detect if the subscript in an array, the index in an array is out of bounds. Some of them, these kind of things cannot be figured out at runtime because you can only check that is an integer, like in Java. You cannot check because the array is not yet created at compile time. You can't check that is within the bounds of that array. So they will be done at dynamic execution time. But still, the semantic analysis does a lot of things. Does type checking, does syntax checking, and checks that all the statements are syntactically correct. Now, all of these phases rely on a special table of all of the symbols in the original program. So all of the identifiers in the program, like variables, method names, are put in what is called the symbol table. So if any one of these phases needs the value of a variable or update the value of a variable, they can directly go to the symbol table and modify the value of that variable, okay? And access the value of that variable. So the semantic analysis phase does this building and maintaining the symbol table. It also does context checking. Every identifier is checked that is declared before it's used. No identifier is used in an inappropriate context, like adding a string to an integer in Python. Subroutine calls provide the correct number and types of arguments. If you call a method, you call it with correct number of arguments and the type of those arguments. And basically it does those things that can be checked at static compile time, when you basically have the information to do that correction, that error correction. This semantic analysis is implemented with what are called action routines. So what basically happens is that the parse tree would have pointers to methods that will be executed to check, to do these checks. So basically we are obtaining from one tree that was just a parse tree, and this parse tree was just a tree that represents the syntax in that program, a new type of tree called the abstract syntax tree, which basically has also execution attached to the nodes in this tree. So this parse tree was very verbose. Much of the information is irrelevant for the next phases of computation, like open parentheses or brackets, semicolons, things like that. So basically the semantic analyzer gives you a new tree called abstract syntax tree, which removes all of those artificial nodes which were related to the syntax. And it basically gives you a data structure that you can execute as your program. And in the next phases, in fact, this abstract syntax tree is optimized. So the compiler in the next phase would see patterns in this abstract syntax tree that it has seen before and transform them into simplified such patterns. That's the optimization. So for that GCD program that you saw before, this is the obtained abstract syntax tree, where you basically have a tree that represents the program, was basically a call to get the integer type. If in our case, that was the type of the int method. And for that, you have another integer. Then you have a while statement. You have a condition for the while statement. And then the body of the multiple statements within the while statement. So basically the abstract syntax tree is a much simplified tree, which fits in one slide, which has connections to the symbol table. In many compilers, this abstract syntax tree is basically the intermediate form, which is passed through multiple optimizers. And basically these optimizers are traversing this tree to generate some other intermediate forms, more optimal ones. So this intermediate form, next phase in the compilation is basically a step that does compilation into lower level code, like for instance, machine level or assembly code. Usually there are two phases. There is an optimization phase, which optimizes this ASP, AFSA syntax tree, or even the intermediate code. And then there is a final target code generation phase in which this abstract syntax tree is actually compiled into the lower level language, the language, the machine language or assembly language. And here is the same program that we started in GCD that is basically generates from parse tree, abstract syntax tree, the assembly language for that same program. Now, some improvements are machine independent and they can be done on the abstract syntax tree. Some improvements are actually done on the target machine language directly in assembly. And these are the optimization phases in a compilation. Now, we are not going to actually implement such a programming language from scratch. I included lecture notes in the rest of the semester, which describes how parsing is done. And in fact, I included code that in Python that allows one to write a parser. I also included how names are reasoned in semantic analysis, basically how the environment variables are created based on the various scoping rules. What are the scope rules for your programming language? I also included semantic analysis, how it generates the abstract syntax tree. But probably the topic that we will spend most of the rest of the time on is functional programming. And if you take a look at Blackboard, you would see that the next five labs after this week was basically labs on graphs, but afterwards the rest of the labs this semester are on functional programming. And in fact, instead of asking you to implement them, I already implement all of these labs for you. So you can basically understand and know how to implement functions in SML and test them. And some of the labs are not implemented. I gave one lab, lab 24. But all of these are items. Starting next week, you don't need to submit the lab anymore. You just need to do it yourself during the lab. We are here to help and to explain every single program, but you don't need to submit it anymore. I will basically consider all of the labs up to now.
Are you grading like attendance for that then? Or are you just saying like you honor system, we're doing it?
Basically I seen it for 20 different labs that everybody did it properly. I see no point to do this for the last five labs. You can basically do it on your own. I will be during the lab and the TAs too. But if you don't need help, then just basically do the lab on your own. I will not take any attendance. Okay, excellent question. So why functional programming is important? And for that, I will give you as an example my other course, CSE 316. So this semester I'm teaching two courses, CSE 260, our data structures course combined with programming languages, and fundamentals of software development, which really it's a course that teaches mostly JavaScript. And one feature of JavaScript that is extremely useful, and I actually do not think I have it in this set of slides, but I do have it in the slides on React, is the fact that you have second order functions. So let me show it to you. Here is an example. So this is a method, render. But this method render basically takes another argument, which is a function itself. So I will render using this component, this test app that I created above, the location. So I will render the location for the element root in the HTML page, but because I need to get that location at runtime on the client, I need to call another method. So I basically pass a function as an argument to another function. And this is extremely important. The fact that now arguments inside a function can be other functions themselves. Okay. And really, this is very important for web applications. Because for web applications, when you're returning an answer for one computer to another computer, you basically need to tell the other computer what to call back to give me an answer back. So maybe it's not the best example, but the fact, the reason why functional programming is so important today is the fact that we have distributed computing, that you have cases in which you cannot stay and wait for the other computer to give you the answer, like we did when we call methods on in a program, on a standalone application. We have to give to the other computer a function to call back, to basically pass us back the answer. So this is not quite an example of that, but it is an example of a function that takes another function as a parameter. Next class, we'll get into details of functional programming, but we will do it at a higher level. We will basically do it at the level of functional programming. And really, if you want to get into more details, our class had two textbooks. One was the original textbook on Java and data structures, and the second one is paradigms of programming languages. So programming languages pragmatics, which is really a principles of programming languages topic. And that's what I wanted to cover today. Basically the different types of programming languages, the different steps in a programming language compilation or interpretation. And next class, we start with functional programming. I don't think that we'll basically do other things this semester. I included other lecture notes like logic programming and how logic programming basically maps to first order logic. But we will probably not do any of this. We will only do functional programming the rest of this semester. Okay. Okay. If there are no questions, I will basically stop the recording and you can continue with the lab.